Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our webinar about digital testing overview for the Connecticut SAT School Day. Thank you very much for taking the time out to attend this webinar. And also thank you in advance for all the work that you're going to be doing in preparation for the 2022 Connecticut SAT School Day. Just a couple of reminders, a little housekeeping. We're happy to take your questions. There's a question box. You can type those right in there. Additionally, there are several handouts in the handout section, copies of these slides, and some other relevant handouts that I hope you'll find useful. You can download those from the handout section. And for those of you that don't know me, my name is Michelle Rosato, and I work at the Connecticut State Department of Education on the Connecticut SAT School Day. We're going to do some introductions first, and then we'll get started. So, Dina.
Hi, my name is Dina Johnson. I am currently filling in as the new Alan Bernstein. If you haven't heard, Alan has left the College Board, so I manage the New England Regional Office, and I am really happy to be working with Connecticut. I have a lot of experience working with digital SAT states in New Hampshire and Rhode Island, so happy to join today.
Thanks, Dina. Deirdre?
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Deirdre Ducharme. I work at the Connecticut State Department of Education, and I'm here to support you and your students on issues related to special populations, including students with disabilities and English learners. Great to be with you today, here with you today.
And special thank you to Barbara. Barbara, can you just introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Barbara Ventura. I'm an assistant principal at Berlin High School. I've been administering the digital PSAT for the last few years, so hopefully I'll be able to offer some helpful hints or be a resource if you have some questions.
Keisha?
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Keisha Smith. I am the Senior Director of SSD Customer Service. I provide support to CSDE for the implementation of SAT School Day for the accommodations for students testing with accommodations and supports.
Thanks, Abe.
Hi, thanks, Michelle. Thanks, everyone, for coming out. I'm Abe Christ. I'm a Bureau Chief in the Performance Office at CSDE. We oversee all our state assessments, and thank you for taking the time out to come out this afternoon. And thanks also to the awesome CSDE team and College Board team, the district. You guys are all in good hands with this great team who have sort of worked us through the shift over the last few years. So again, thank you.
And last but not least, Adrienne Cupper, and she's gonna also take you through this presentation. Adrienne.
Thank you, Michelle. Hi, good afternoon, everybody. As Michelle said, I'm Adrienne. I work at the College Board and I support the implementation of the SAT, the Connecticut SAT. So all of the kind of logistical stuff you need to do, any questions you have, Michelle works with me. And so we work together on this. So I'm gonna take you through today's presentation. And then at various points of the presentation, a couple people are gonna pop on and also talk about some stuff. So with that, let's get started.
Adrienne, I forgot I had like a couple of the poll questions I wanted to do real quick, if that's okay with everyone.
Yes.
And also that's my dog Stella on the slide. That's her Halloween costume. There we go. All right, so our first question, let's see if I can do this. Have you been involved in the administration of the NGSS? If you could just let us know if you've been involved in that digital testing. Go ahead and vote. Okay, I'm going to close it in just 1 second. All right, so we have 42% yes and 48% no. So that's good because some of the systems are similar. In terms of SAT School Day, are you new to your role this year and working on the administration of the Connecticut SAT School Day? All right, just another moment. All right, I'm going to close that up. So we had about 70% are veterans. They've come back again. So thank you. Really glad. And then we have about 30% of you that are new. So don't worry. We're here to answer your questions and help you through it. And then this is our last one. Have you administered a digital version of a College Board test such as PSAT? All right, just another moment. All right, so we had 82% have not administered a digital version and about 18% have. So useful information. Thank you very much for participating in those polls. And now I am truly going to turn it over to Adrian. Thanks, Adrian.
Thank you, Michelle. Okay, so we will get rolling here. Before we get into content though, just so you have it, and so you get to see Stella in the last slide. This is my cat, Freddie, in this slide. The contact information for folks, now you will see this at the end of the presentation as well. And this information is in the deck that's also been uploaded into the files that you have access to in GoToMeeting. We have contact information here for Michelle and Deirdre if you need them. If you have College Board questions, you can reach out to the College Board, and the number and the email address are there. So let's just get rolling into content and we'll go from there. So the first thing just to start off and talk about is just the test dates. The primary test dates for the Connecticut SAT School Day for this spring, March 23rd through 25th and March 29th through 30th, there is a digital window for testing. And so you can use one day in that window. You can use every day in that window if you want to, but you have the option to test on multiple days with the digital SAT. Then there is the accommodated testing window. So these are for students that that in the paper pencil world would use the Blue Book. So you may be familiar with that. So the accommodated testing window runs March 23rd through April 5th. And then the makeup test dates, again, there is a short window for makeup test dates, so April 26th through 28th. So again, if you want to administer makeup tests to your students on one of those days, you can, or you can break students up across the 3 days. The digital test experience is designed to give you some flexibility for administering the test to your students. So just a couple key points to talk about here. So for College Board digital assessments this year, we are administering them in partnership with Cambium Assessments, CAI. And so I know that CAI is used also in Connecticut for NGSS testing and other things. And so the systems, a lot of things about the systems will be familiar to you. And then there are a few differences because the SAT works a little differently than some other assessments. Schools that are testing digitally must have all students test in that mode, in the digital mode for an assessment, except for students who have an accommodation that requires paper and pencil testing. So all of your students will be testing digitally unless your student has a need for an accommodation that requires paper pencil testing. And if that's the case, we can support those students. So for digital testing, each student must complete all sections of the test in one day, unless they have been approved for an accommodation, like an extended time accommodation, that has them test over more than one day. For example, extended double time, for example, where a student tests over 2 days. Obviously, that student is supposed to test over 2 days, but other students without an accommodation that extends the time all need to complete the test in one day. And as I mentioned, testing of a window, you can use any of the dates in that window, all of the dates in that window, one of the dates in that window for testing. It's up to you. It's whatever kind of works for your school. Now, all of the students taking the test on the same day need to test at about the same time. So we still offer the COVID-related flexibilities where you can have slightly staggered start times to support kind of social distancing within your school building. So you can have 20 or 30 minutes between start time for a group. You can have one group start at 8:30 and then another group start at 9 to make sure that you have the ability to have more space available for students to move around in kind of check-in spaces or whatnot. But all students do have to test in roughly the same time. So you need to have all students kind of testing in the morning, or all students, all students do need to test in the morning. And you need to just be aware that if you do choose to use the staggered start times, you need to make sure that the first group of students that test aren't completing the test before the last group of students that are gonna test kind of start that test. So this, you know, those are just some things to think about. We can talk more about that. Score reports are made available in the same time frame as those for the students that test with paper and pencil. So just so you know, the digital test, the students don't get their scores released any more quickly. They are in the same time frame as the paper and pencil test. And then in addition to the standard roles for testing, each school needs to have a technology coordinator who is responsible for the technology setup tasks for digital testing. So talking about roles and responsibilities, you'll see on the slide here, this will look familiar to any of you who have worked with us before. There is one additional role though. So the test coordinator is the person in charge of testing, manages all aspects of the testing. And so that person's in charge of the digital testing. And if you have any students that do require paper testing for accommodations, the test coordinator also has to do any setup for that too. The SSD coordinator is the person who is responsible at your school for any accommodations requests and then supporting those students. And then there's the EL coordinator. And in a lot of schools, it may be the same person, but the EL coordinator is, you know, the person who supports any English learner students. And these SSD coordinator and EL coordinator will work with the test coordinator to make sure that the TIDE configurations are set so that students can access their accommodations in digital testing. The technology coordinator, as I mentioned, is the person at the school or at the district, depending on how your district is set up, that's responsible for managing the technical readiness for your school for digital testing. And so that person, you know, kind of knows the ins and outs of your network and hardware and software management and all that kind of stuff to make sure that your school is ready to administer the digital test. Then proctors are obviously the people that are actually administering the test in the testing room to students. They're responsible for the secure, valid administration of the test in the testing room. Sorry, I'll just pop back, I hit that. And then the last role is monitors. So those are kind of other school staff who have been trained to help and support the test coordinator and the proctors. They provide essentially a support system. So if the proctor needs a break, a monitor can be in there with the kids so that students aren't unattended. If the test coordinator needs some assistance, the monitor's there to help them. The monitor also makes sure that the hallways are quiet and that nothing inappropriate is happening in the hallways. There's no sharing of test, you know, discussion of test content or anything. And so those are the roles for digital testing. Now, for digital testing, and this is important to know, especially if you do digital testing, if you've done like digital PSAT 89 testing with us, it works a little different here. The pre-ID upload. CSDE handles the pre-ID upload for Connecticut schools for the Connecticut SAT school day. So what'll happen is CSDE pulls from PSIS the information about the students that are testing for the Connecticut SAT, and then they provide that information to the College Board. And then when they provide that information to the College Board, it then flows through our systems, and then you will be able to see that in the test information distribution engine or the TIDE platform. We'll just call it TIDE from here on in. And that's how coordinators can see the rosters of students that have been uploaded in our testing and can begin to do the digital readiness tasks ahead of test day. So in mid-January, CSDE will upload that student information to College Board. College Board then processes that data, and then in early February, then test coordinators will be provisioned for access to see that information in the College Board's version of TIDE. And so then you will be able to then begin the process of technical readiness because you'll see students at that point. So there are three different kind of platforms you'll be using that are part of the CAI test delivery system. It's important to note that if you do NGSS testing or other digital testing with the state, these will look familiar. And like I said, there are quite a few similarities between them, the reality is that there are also a few little differences. Like I mentioned, the SAT test is a little bit different than other assessments, and so there will be some differences. We'll talk about that along the way. But there are the three systems. There's the test information distribution engine, or TIDE. There's the test administrator interface, or the TA interface, and there's the secure browser. The TIDE platform is what test coordinators use to manage the testing process. The test administration interface, I'm not sure why that keeps jumping, but the test administrator interface is what proctors use in the testing room to manage their testing room, the testing that's happening in their testing room. And then the secure browser is what students use to access and actually take the test. So we'll talk a little bit more about the test information distribution engine. So like I said, test coordinators use this system to manage data and configure settings ahead of test day. And then district administrators as part of the Connecticut SAT will also have access to TIDE to support the test coordinator's management of student data. The test coordinator functions in TIDE involve creating staff accounts, so accounts for proctors who will be administering the test, as well as managing rosters, monitoring digital test sessions, modifying test settings for students with accommodations, and printing student test tickets. And then the test administrator interface, like I said, this is the system that proctors use to administer the digital SAT actually in the testing room. The proctor functions in the TA interface include conducting pre-administration sessions, creating test sessions, approving students into the test sessions, monitoring and managing test timing, and then monitoring student test status. And then you can also identify students who may need assistance. Just to call out here, there is the College Board's version of the test administrator interface has a built-in timing functionality because the timing does need to be consistent for everybody taking the SAT. And so there is a built-in timing functionality. Just something to call out on the timing functionality, you will get test day training. We'll talk about this a little bit later on. But when you have test day training, you'll be able to go and you'll actually see all of these systems and be part of kind of simulations of these systems. And you'll see how these work in detail when you take your test day training. And then there is the secure browser, and this is the student functionality, as I mentioned. This is how students access and take the test. Schools are required to download and install the secure browser on the student test-taking devices. The secure browser secures the desktop and prevents any access to any access to anything outside of the test, and also collects the student responses for the test. Now, just one call out. So this is a little bit of a difference from your experience in other testing with CAI to the College Board testing, is that students will use their registration number instead of their state student ID. And so that is provided on their test ticket. Now, a little bit of information about schools that are already using CAI. Schools already using the CAI system and the secure browser will need to complete some technical setup tasks in order to administer the Connecticut SAT school day. And it depends on the operating system and the devices you're using. You'll need to install one of the applications that's on the screen. So the CB secure browser is for devices running on Windows or Mac OS. And so it doesn't replace your state testing browsers. You'll have to download the CB secure browser if you're testing on Windows or Mac OS, but you can have the state testing browser as well as the CB secure browser on the device at the same time. It doesn't replace it, but you will need to download the College Board secure browser to deliver that test. Now, the secure test browser, this is the application that's used on Chromebooks and iPads. If your school is already using CAI for other assessments and you're testing on the Chromebooks and iPads, the secure test browser that you use for other assessments can be used for the College Board assessments. You just need to change the organization and assessment settings in the secure test browser before students can actually access the test. Now, some call outs for test coordinators and proctors. So if you're already using CAI systems for other tests, test coordinators and proctors will use the same CAI products to administer the test, right? We've talked about TIDE, we've talked about the TA interface, but there is some differences in how you actually get to them. Testing staff will need to log in to the CAI systems differently. So instead of going to, basically what will happen is test coordinators and proctors come to the College Board's digital testing portal and log into College Board's version of TIDE and College Board's version of the TA interface from the digital testing portal. And that way you're getting into, as I mentioned, there are some differences in these products a little bit because the test works a little differently. So you come to the College Board digital testing platform and you log into TIDE or TA interface from our digital testing digital testing portal. I'm sorry. Now, you may see differences for what appears for students in College Board, especially if you're looking in TIDE, or you may see differences of what data you're seeing in TIDE for students versus what you may be seeing for TIDE for students in TIDE for other assessments. So just be aware of that. It may look a little bit different. But if you're testing the same student, so let's say you're testing students for Connecticut SAT School Day, and then you're testing them for another assessment that's in the CAS system, you're going to see them represented in differently in each of the systems. So they're going to be, you're going to see them in College Board system, and then you're going to see them in the for SAT testing. Then you're going to see them in the other CAS system that you use for the other testing. So it's just important to know they're going to be. You'll see students in both places. That's okay. You want to make sure though, when you're in the College Board TIDE system, you see all your students, and that's how you manage the students who are taking the digital SAT. So the digital testing portal, there's links to the digital testing portal all throughout this deck, but also the digital testing portal, the website, my screen just went blank. So I'm talking. So hopefully my screen has come back. Hopefully you can see that.
We still see the PowerPoint. I didn't know if you were trying to open up the website.
I was going to, but I'm a little bit concerned now that it just went away. we'll do that at the end. Okay. If we still have time.
Okay. Cause I can always do it too, if you needed me to.
Okay. So. Great. So we'll, like I said, I'm a little bit nervous that it went away. So let's go through the rest of the presentation. We'll go back to the website at the
end. Okay.
And
then there's Deirdre and I have been answering questions and responding to everybody, but there are a few that are in there that I don't know the answers to. So we'll take some time at the end.
No problem. So we'll, so that's no problem. So anyway, so this is the digital testing portal. You see the website on the screen.
Sorry to stop you, Adrian. There's a pop-up on your screen of the control panel for go to. It's like, oh, there it goes. Okay, good. Good. It's gone.
Okay. Let's see. Great. Alrighty. Okay, so we'll get back to that. Sorry about the technical issues. So anyway, this is what the digital testing portal looks like. You come in, you'll see a lot of options, and then you can get to a lot of information for the College Board digital assessments from the digital testing portal. Like I said, we'll go there at the end. This way we won't have whatever, hopefully, technical issue I just had. So we'll keep moving forward. Let's see here. Okay, we have through the digital testing portal, there are practice sites that are available so that students can practice. They can be part of the student. They can use the student digital test preview to experience what a digital test is like. There's a TA interface practice site so that the proctors can go in and practice before test day and have that experience prior to test day so that they are more comfortable and they feel better about administering the test. We really recommend that as part of the, let me get back to that, that as part of the your kind of readiness activities, try to incorporate at least into your kind of proctor training and preparations, having your proctors just use the TA interface practice site a little bit to get more comfortable. And we definitely recommend that students go in and try to and just, you know, use the practice site. We also have on our digital testing portal an interactive proctor simulation. And that, as I mentioned, that helps proctors go through and just kind of see step by step and kind of experience, and they get to click on things themselves, but get more comfortable with the TA interface so that on test day it can go smoothly for them. So there's a lot of information. Like I said, all of this is accessible through the digital testing portal. Michelle, do you want me to stop now and take some questions? Or do you want me to wait all the way till the end?
I think it might be good to take a couple of questions right now. I'll just read them to you.
Sounds good.
Okay, so it was mentioned that the secure test browser is the same, I'm not sure I really understand this, but kiosk app, but a different organization has to be changed in the secure test browser. Is that change made by each student by doing the button at the bottom, which says something like change organization?
I believe it can be done more globally, but I can get that answer for you. I believe it can be done kind of globally by the test coordinator, but I'm not 100% sure, so we can follow up with that answer.
Okay. Let's see. How do certified teachers get logins for the College Board?
So what will happen is, as part of kind of the school establishment process, your school provided information to the College Board about your test coordinator and your test coordinator and your SSD coordinator and other folks. Once we have the upload information from CSDE, so the student upload file from CSDE in January, we will then begin provisioning access to TIDE to test coordinators. And so you will receive an email from the College Board that will have your access and provide you with the ability to access TIDE and all of your credentials to access that. And then once the test coordinator has access to TIDE, then you can begin adding staff into the system, so that then your proctors will begin to be able to get access to the TA interface. And so, but the test coordinator will be provisioned to access. You'll get an email from the College Board, and then you can then add staff to also be able to access the systems.
Thanks. And sort of related to that is, would they use their same login information that they use when they access SBAC and NGSS, or is it something different?
I believe it will be different login information. I'm not 100% certain about that, because I'm not exactly sure what information you use, like what you're actually using to log in for other tests. But the email you get will have everything you need to be able to log in to TIDE.
Okay, let's see, sorry. People are asking about the ability to test on Chromebooks.
Yes, so there is the ability to test on Chromebooks. We do support Chromebooks for testing.
I think that most of the details about the technology specifications are included on the College Board's digital testing website. And I'm sure you have a link to that later on.
Yes.
And let me see. We might just, people asked about the pre-administration session. Do they have to hold one?
We'll get there later in the presentation.
Okay. Why don't we keep going and then we can come back to this?
Great. Sounds good.
Okay.
So let's talk about preparing for digital testing. So to get to that question of technical readiness, right? There are things that need to be done to prepare for digital testing. There's a checklist of things that we have for you to go through to be able to make sure that you've done all of the things you need to do. I'm not going to go through all the items on this particular list at this point because it's kind of a lot of details here. But we have the checklist. It's in the deck that you can kind of download. And we'll be going through items in detail with the technology coordinators. We have a technology coordinator webinar. Sorry about that, it keeps jumping. We have a technology coordinator overview webinar on November 18th at 1 p.m. So the technology coordinators can go through the detail information for setup with us at that point. Now, just a few things to know, just to kind of go through device information. And as you know, you'll hear a lot of, there is lots of details on the digital testing portal. There's lots of details about everything that we do on the digital testing portal. You'll find more information about devices there. But devices, you just have to make sure they meet the minimum setup requirements. We have a step-by-step tech specification, kind of step-by-step guide to setup. And so you want to make sure all devices meet those system requirements. Schools need to have the ability to install the secure test browser client application on all test-taking devices. As we mentioned, desktops, laptops, iPads, and Chromebooks are allowed. Now, iPads, Apple iPads with a 9.7-inch display are allowed. Apple iPads have to be fourth generation or higher, and iPad minis can't be used. Devices need to be able to connect to the internet. It doesn't matter if it's wired or wireless, but they have to have internet connectivity. Devices have to be school-owned. Now, it's okay if the device is school-owned, but the kids take them home. So, you know, if every student has a Chromebook, the school issued a Chromebook to every student and students take it back and forth, that's okay, but it has to be school-owned and the school has to be able to control what's on there. And then devices have to be able to maintain a charge for at least 5 hours or be able to be plugged in for the time of testing. Each testing room must have a dedicated device that the proctor uses then to access the TA interface. And then students who do have some sort of approved assistive technology device, so they have an accommodation where they get to use, where they are able to use an assistive technology device, should really pretest the device using the secure browser and the student digital test preview prior to test day, just to make sure everything runs smoothly for them. So again, here are some details for the guidance for determining bandwidth. Again, I'm not going to go through all these details. We will cover this information in more detail in the tech coordinator webinar, but this information is in the deck for you. So if you download the deck, if you want to share it with your technology coordinator, please feel free to do so. A few basics about students with accommodations. Now, again, we are going to do two very detailed webinars on accommodations coming up. We have an SSD and accommodations overview webinar that's set to take place on Monday at 1 p.m. And that's going to cover just the ins and outs of College Board accommodations and also requesting accommodations. So that's at 1 p.m. on November 8th. And then on December 6th at 1 p.m., we have a session that will focus specifically on accommodations and TIDE and SAT school day for Connecticut, and kind of making sure that you know what to do and how to configure TIDE to support the accommodations for SAT school day. So that focuses specifically on the digital testing, what to do to prepare to then administer those accommodations and what you need to do in terms of tech preparedness for that. So just a couple things though, some basics on the College Board accommodations requests. All accommodations requests are submitted through the College Board SSD online system. That window for submission is November 29th through February 2nd. And then students that are already approved for College Board accommodations in the paper testing mode, let's say you took PSAT and MSQT in the fall and they've already gotten an accommodation that they are approved for, they don't need a new request. Students are provided for an equivalent accommodation in digital testing. The digital test is accessible for students with accommodations. So accommodated testing needs to be set up before testing. So you will use the NAR, the non-standard administration report, as a guide, and then schools indicate in the TIDE system on a student record if the student is testing with accommodations. And schools also need to indicate if a student is receiving the extended time EL support, time and a half for students with EL, or if the student's using a non-embedded, an accommodation that's not embedded in the platform. We will cover this particular topic. If you have questions, I understand it may be different. It's a different experience. We will cover this in detail, lots and lots of detail, on December 6th at 1 p.m. So if you have questions about that, we'll cover the content and we will answer all the questions about this particular topic at that point. So we just want to make sure that you're aware of that. We will cover all the different ways you can set things up and all the different kinds of things you need to do. A couple things to know about non-standard testing rooms. Students who require different timing and breaks have to be tested in separate rooms. Okay, I'm sure you're familiar with that process with us. Students who are taking the test with extended time, extra or extended breaks, or other accommodations need to be assigned a room and a proctor that's separate from kids who are taking the standard administration of the test with standard time. You want to seat students with the same timing and breaks together, right? So this may mean you have several digital testing rooms, but you want kids that have the same timing and the same breaks together. And you want to provide appropriately configured test-taking devices and resources to support the student's accommodations. So what does that mean? Like we said, especially if you have a student that's using some sort of assistive technology, you want to check it in advance to make sure that that works with the CAI system for taking the Connecticut SAT school day, and just make sure that device supports what the student needs. And then students, like I said, can test in the paper mode if they have an accommodation that requires paper testing. And so we do support that. Students testing in the paper mode do need to be in a different room from digital testers. There are a number of test settings and tools to be aware of. And so some of the accessibility features in our digital testing are universal, meaning that everybody can access it. And then others are for students who have approved accommodations, who have disabilities that require the approved accommodation, or an EL student that needs timing support. And so those are set up by the SSD coordinator or the test coordinator in time before test day. So the universal tools are on your left, things like the calculator for the math test, the calculator section of the math test. We have an embedded calculator, context menu, expand button, highlighter, line focus, mark for review, navigation buttons, notes, question drop-down list, reference and math formula sheet, a strike through or an option eliminator, there's a student clock, and there's zoom in and zoom out up to a certain point. All of this is available in the universal tools for every student, but then there are things that require adjustment of test settings prior to test day. So things like if a student has an approval for color contrast, or they're an English learner that has time in one half, or really any student that has a timing accommodation, if there's a mouse pointer or a four function calculator for the non-calculator section of the math test, there are a bunch of things that require set up before test day. Like I said, in the webinar we do in December, we're going to cover all of this. Also, if there's a non-embedded accommodation, so something that is given, like a permission to test food or permission to have food or medication during testing, that is a non-embedded accommodation. There's nothing in the testing system to support it, but you just check off that the student does have a non-embedded accommodation. Like I said, we will cover this in lots and lots and lots of detail in December. We'll show you lots of screens of what you need to do. The student digital test preview provides an overview of the student test experience, and all students can see the overview of the universal test tools in the site. So they'll be able to see the navigation buttons, the clock, the various tools, the context menu, just so that kids can become familiar with the testing platform prior to the test administration. So we recommend taking a look at that. And then for the pre-administration session, let's chat about that because I know we had some questions. We strongly, strongly recommend doing a pre-administration session before test day. Everybody benefits because the students have the opportunity to use the digital testing platform, practice it. Proctors have the opportunity to practice administering a portion of the testing experience for students. And test coordinators can confirm that your school is technically ready to do this. However, if you can't do the pre-administration session before test day, we do understand. So students can complete their score sends on test day if that's needed. It just extends your test day by a little bit. So we do really, really recommend doing it before test day, just because it gives everybody a chance to practice and it shortens your test day a bit. So the testing room setup, test coordinators, they need to identify and prepare the spaces for digital testing prior to the test itself. We have a lot of guidelines on the digital testing portal for room configuration. but we have guidelines for testing stations that are configured. You want to prevent testers from easily viewing the screens of other students near them. You want to make sure there's enough space for testing devices and the use of scratch paper and calculators. Kids are allowed to use scratch paper for digital testing, and so you want to be able to make sure there's enough space to allow that without students seeing each other's work. Kind of lap boards are not permitted. Students have to be at desks or tables. Each testing room must have a dedicated computer for the proctor, a test-taking device for each student, and access to a reliable power source for test-taking devices. And just like any testing you do with College Board, you want to make sure that the room is free of distractions, has adequate lighting and ventilation, and you want to make sure that restrooms are nearby. So for assigning students to testing rooms and just being aware of assigning students and proctors, you will need at least one proctor for each testing room up to 25 students. So you can have up to 25 students, you have one proctor. If you end up having more, anywhere from 26 to 50 students, you need that proctor and you need to add a room monitor. And you see on the chart, for numbers of students, how many proctors you need, you always need one proctor. And then if you need any additional room monitors. And for seating and spacing requirements, let's talk through this a little bit. Partitions are allowed for digital testing to divide test takers. In fact, we recommend them for digital testing. You want to make sure that partitions conceal a student's writing surface or testing device from other students, but they don't obstruct the proctor's visibility so that the proctor can still see what's going on. Now, seating distance no less than 3 feet apart side to side and 5 feet back to back or front to back. Again, if you're kind of COVID related, if there are local requirements or your school requirements that require more than 3 feet, you should go with your local requirement, at least though 3 feet apart for students. And then students, face-to-face seating is allowed in digital testing, but only if partitions are being used. And then students can be facing the same direction, but again, it's allowed and we recommend the use of partitions. So we do have a couple diagrams in here. And again, we'll just talk briefly through this, but you'll have these. These are in the deck that you can download. You can look at them more closely. We have back-to-back seating options, a back-to-back seating option with partitions, front-to-back seating options, and then a front-to-back seating with partitions. And then, as I mentioned, there's a U-shaped seating option without partitions, U-shaped seating with partitions. There's a little bit of, because we can use partitions with digital testing, you have a little bit of flexibility and options for seating configurations. So then we're gonna switch here. This is where you get to hear somebody other than me talk. And so we're gonna talk a little bit about kind of student, the benefits of digital testing, and kind of the experiences of students and educators. And so I am going to turn it over to Dina for a few minutes here to talk about the digital school day benefits for students.
So thank you, Adrian. I think that overall, all of these benefits have been generated by New Hampshire and Rhode Island educators who really see taking the SAT digitally as an advantage over taking the SAT paper pencil. So the first thing that they noted to me was it's just simpler test-taking experience. Students don't have to flip through test books. They don't need number two pencils. There's no threat of a student misbubbling. So they start bubbling in their answer sheet. They get the first one wrong or get one wrong and it's off. And then they've got to erase the whole thing. It's really easy for kids to find skipped questions. So I know Adrian sort of mentioned this earlier, but kids can flag questions that they want to return to. So students can really easily move between questions and change answers if they need to change an answer. And this reduces what we sort of dub pencil fatigue. So if students don't have the practice of constantly bubbling in answer sheets, it can be really taxing to them to sit still for 3+ hours and do that in one sitting. So this tends to be a simpler test-taking experience. I know Adrian also mentioned those integrated test-taking tools, those built-in tools that really also help to enhance and simplify the test testing experience for students. So she hit on a few of these already, but the calculators, students don't have to worry about bringing an approved calculator. There's an on-screen timer, so students don't need to bring a watch, or you don't need to ensure that students have access to a clock in the room. There's a highlighting feature, and that highlighting feature is available for all students. So it can really help students that would benefit just from reading things on the screen, just to highlight certain portions or a reading passage. There's also a line reader, which can also aid students, all students, in getting through the questions more carefully. And then there's an answer eliminator. So if a student reads a question and they can eliminate a few of the answers, they can actually do that and cross out answers on the screen. Something else that New Hampshire, in particular, educators noted is that the accommodations they feel are more easily administered. Accessibility is built in for some students who would otherwise need an accommodation like Scribe or large print. And those integrated test-taking tools, like I mentioned, are available for all students. And overall, they feel that the accommodations are easier to manage because setup is completed in advance. So the room proctor can't activate a test for a student with an accommodation if that student's not in the correct room. And they saw that as a huge benefit. For a lot of students, this familiar testing environment, a lot of students already are acquainted with the digital testing platform. And I know the poll at the very start of today's session indicated that a little less than half of you deal with the NGSS. But for students, I would think that most of your students are really familiar with taking the test digitally, or taking a test digitally. And as Adrian mentioned, that pre-administration session where students can do and use the platform and get really familiar with it is a huge benefit. This is a huge asset for all students. And Adrian, I don't know if you can go to the next slide. There's fewer physical materials to manage. And above all, I think that educators have reported that this is their most favorite thing about digital testing. There are no test books to store. There are no student answer sheets to collect. They don't have to organize anything. They don't have to ship anything when testing is complete. When testing is done, testing is actually complete. There are some centralized administrative features in CIA or Cambium, that really also help. So before test day, you can generate your test tickets, you can manage your rosters, you can configure your accommodations. And then on test day, you will see student testing time on that screen. You'll see if any students have extended time, and you can monitor students' progression throughout the test. So overall, like I just mentioned, when the test is over, the test is over. Proctors simply dismiss their students. So we have seen huge benefits in moving to the digital testing experience in both New Hampshire and Rhode Island. And I'm sure you'll experience something very similar this year as Connecticut makes that shift.
Great, thanks, Dina. And then we have some, we do have somebody, an educator here to talk with us. So we have Barbara Ventura, who is the assistant principal at Berlin High School. And so Barbara, if you wouldn't mind sharing some of your experiences.
Just to echo, the biggest concern that we find, the kids are completely experienced and comfortable taking digital tests in Berlin. It's generally the proctors, it's teachers, they've never administered a digital test before. Making your proctors more comfortable, going through the presentation real quick. One of the things I do is they don't know where kids find the secure browser. So I do a print off of the screen with an arrow pointing. This is where the kids click for the secure browser. I try to make sure that the proctors go to the practice site so that they are very comfortable. Sometimes it's through study halls and they grab a kid or two and they start the practice administration site so that they know what it looks like and it feels like, so that they are not all concerned. The other thing we found, and it's only happened once, but we have one-to-one devices with our Chromebooks. One time we went into a testing situation and there was an update. So what we do is like an advisory a day or two before, we have all kids shut down and log in just in case there's some type of an update, a systems update that may take 15, 20, 30 minutes to download. We also asked our proctors if they, once they're assigned to the rooms and the dedicated device, go in and take a look at the room and log into that computer. What you'll find is as they're using their laptop and doing the practice, but then they go into the actual testing site and they're using a teacher's desktop per se, they'll be getting some emails about verifying, in fact, that they are using a different device to do the login. And another thing we do, and this is on our tech side, is because we are one-to-one devices, we don't test in a computer lab. We test on the students' Chromebooks. We're all in one section of the building. Our tech integration specialist always has about 20 or 30 additional Chromebooks charged in case a kid comes in with a lower charge Chromebook. Oh, they forgot their Chromebook. For whatever the reason is, the Chromebook dies in the middle of testing, it's a very easy and quick swap out. Those are some of the little bit of the highlights, but I don't know if there's any specific questions.
So thank you, Barbara, for that. That was great. Michelle, do you want to wait until we get through this to take any questions, or do you want to do any questions now?
There's quite a number of questions. We've been trying to keep up with things. And I know we're definitely gonna have to follow up with everybody. Probably I'll produce a list of all the questions with the answers and just share them with all of you. So why don't we at least get through your resources and then see how much time remains. There was one thing I just wanna draw the attention to that indicated that the webinar for tech coordinators was on the 18th and it's actually on the 17th of November. I just was going to double check that to make sure. Yes, it's on the 17th of November, not on the 18th. So sorry about that mistake. So okay. Why don't you go through, Adrian, and then we'll see if we have time at the end.
Okay, no problem. We just have a couple more slides. Just to let you know, we do have a lot of resources available for you. Like I mentioned at the digital testing portal, there's a lot of stuff available there. Checklists, practice sites, guides, step-by-step guides, technology guides and system requirements. There's a lot of stuff there. So the digital testing portal is a great resource to use. We do recommend that relating to the digital testing portal, you review the test day planning and digital preparedness information that's on the digital testing portal. That the test coordinators and technology coordinators do work together to make sure that that everything is set. And then, you'll begin configuring your testing devices. You don't have to do that right now, but in advance of test day, you want to make sure that you're downloading things, you're configuring your test devices, and that everything is ready to go. You want to give yourself plenty of time to do that. Like we said, familiarize your students and staff with the format of the digital administration. Now, as I mentioned, there will be training for you, test day training. So what will happen is in the spring, about 6 weeks before testing, you will get digital test coordinators get access to the digital test coordinator training, as well as a TIDE training. The TIDE training is like a walkthrough of a lot of the different features in TIDE. There's also a digital proctor training that's available. As I mentioned, that's actually available via the digital testing portal. Proctors can access that if you want your proctors to go through that experience. And then we also do have an on-demand online training for coordinators if you are in a school where a student needs to take a paper pencil test. A student has an accommodation for that. There is a module available for coordinators to watch to support those students. But all of these trainings are available on demand and kind of online. You'll get an email 6 weeks before the test to be able to access these trainings and go through them. And so as we talked about, there are some upcoming webinars. We have the accommodations overview The technology coordinator overview, as Michelle mentioned, that's actually the 17th. And then the accommodations tied in Connecticut SAT webinar, where we will go through how you actually configure settings in TIDE for accommodations. So those are our upcoming webinars. So let's go back to questions and we'll take whatever we've got. Michelle, do you want to prioritize anything that might be for Barbara since we are only lucky enough to have her right now?
I don't know of anything specific to Barbara. So there are just a lot of questions. And I know that some of you have specific questions about entering accommodations into TIDE, and we're going to cover that on the December 6th webinar in detail. And some of you had questions about the role of the tech coordinator that will be covered on the 17th of November. We're going to get into more details about lots of the things that people are asking about. But like I said, we will definitely go through these questions and produce answers to them and get that out to you. So a lot of people were asking about whether you can bring a device to school or students need to test on a school-owned device. So yeah, could you address that?
Absolutely. Students need to test on a school-owned device. Students cannot use student-owned devices. They must be school-owned. It is okay if the school owns it and the students take them home for remote learning or whatever they're doing with it, but the device must be school owned.
All right. And like I said, I know that Deirdre answered some questions. I did too, as well as Keisha. A lot of people are wanting to know when they're going to get their login, when they're going to get their TIDE account. What's the timeline on that?
Yes. So you will get, test coordinators will get the email with their login information to be able to go into TIDE in the beginning of February. So like I said, PSIS, the CSDE takes the data available in PSIS and provides that to College Board in mid-January. We then process that data and make sure that those students show up in your for your schools. And then in the beginning of February, we then send you an email that has your login information and directs you to go log into TIDE so that you can then see that information and begin your preparation.
Great. Let's see. Someone was asking about double and triple data entry. Why can't data be mass loaded into the TIDE system? We are loading. I'm not sure if you mean like registration information, because that is being loaded into TIDE from PSIS directly. So you're not responsible for loading any demographic information about your grade 11 students. That will be done by the CSDE through College Board. So I'm not sure if that was what the question was. And there'll be a schedule of when we'll be doing the file uploads. It won't be nightly, but it will be pretty regularly right around the testing time to account for students moving in and out. Adrian, can you just mention briefly the rules for staff proctoring if they have a child taking the test?
Sure. So if an educator has a child that will be taking the Connecticut SAT school day, that educator cannot have any access to testing materials prior to school day, prior to the test day. Now, in digital testing, it's a little bit easier than paper testing, right? Because you can't actually see that test until the actual test day in digital testing. So proctors, if a proctor has a child taking the test, they can still proctor the test if you need them to do that. They can't proctor their own child. So if their child is taking the test at your school, they cannot proctor their own child, but they can proctor because they will not have access to the test before test day. Now, if you have any students who are taking the test with an accommodation that requires paper pencil testing, you wanna make sure that if the person proctoring those students with accommodations, you wanna make sure that that proctor does not have any access to test materials before test day.
Thanks. A lot of people asked about proctors. Do they need to be a certified teacher? And the answer is no, they just need to all be trained. And if they are not a certified teacher, they should be working under the direction of a certified staff member. We're going to talk about this on the December 6th, but the question is, why do we need to enter accommodations into TIDE if they're already entered into SSD?
So the SSD system handles the kind of the approvals for accommodations, right? And that's where you let us know what a student needs. The SSD system and the TIDE system are not connected. And so for students that have accommodations that require a configuration in TIDE, you will need to go through and do that. And so we'll like Michelle said, we'll talk about that and exactly what needs to be set in the student's record in the December webinar.
And just for there was a question about PSIS, and will you be able to update PSIS data and up until the date of testing? Yeah, we would like you to make sure that you're continually updating PSIS with the proper information, because that is what we're using to register students. And so the files will go in. It takes, I think it's a day for it to update into the College Board system. So we're going to be putting files in quite regularly around the testing windows. So please make sure that your PSIS data is correctly in the system. So we definitely can use your help on that. So can a test coordinator have a child taking the SAT school day? And then someone asked about the test prep. If you work for one, a test prep company, can you proctor? No, you can't, right?
No, if you work for a test prep company, you cannot proctor. If the test coordinator has a child taking the test, again, it works a little bit differently for digital testing, right? Because you're not getting testing material sent to you. You can't actually access that test material until test day. So I would say what you want to do is you want to let us know, right? So we have a record and that we provide you with all the information to make sure that there's nobody can question the kind of propriety of the situation. But if you are the test coordinator, we can support you to still operate as the test coordinator. You just want to make sure that you have no access to test materials before test day. For digital testing, not a big deal. But if a student has an accommodation, is taking a paper test, you should not have access to that material before test day either. So you may need to enlist the help of somebody else at school to like receive and store the materials.
Okay. I want to be respectful of everyone's time and we're 2 minutes over, but just one last thing before we close, even though I know there was a lot of questions, like I said, we will make sure to get that to you. Will there be paper copies of the manuals that will be sent out, or is the expectation that proctors read from a computer?
No, we will send out paper copies of the manuals for you. You'll get those. So digital copies of the manuals, we'll be able, Michelle will have them to post on the CSDE website in kind of the January, late January, early February timeframe. And then we will send out to you in late February, early March. You will get copies of the actual manuals, the hard copies of the paper manuals.
Yes, and as everyone knows who's worked with me in the past, I send out a lot of emails with making sure that you understand when you're going to be receiving materials and when key dates are happening or they're approaching. But if you have questions, please feel free to send me an email. And again, we appreciate you taking the time to attend this webinar. When you registered for this webinar, you registered for the series of webinars, so you don't need to register again. And you will receive a reminder for each webinar with your unique link to join 1 day and also 1 hour prior to the webinar. Keeping in mind that the reminders are coming from SDE GoToWebinar, so please check your junk folder if you had trouble finding your join link. All right, again, thank you very much. Thank you, Adrian. Thank you, Keisha, Deirdre, Barbara, Dina, Abe. Thanks to all of you in the audience, and I hope you have a nice rest of the day. Thank you.